turn to summarize this slightly more than 40 years of journey, I decide to use the same number or same time scale, so that I will start at the time I was not 6 months old, but already doing my PhD. And it was a time which was very exciting, because it was the dogs. So I was doing my PhD in this period of time in this university under the direction of Juan Rojo. That was approximately the way he was looking at that time. And it was a very interesting time. But like the Chinese said, keep aware, be aware of this interesting time. It could be very dangerous at the same time. So we were trying to change a lot of things at that moment. And my boss, Professor Rojo, told me one day that I would have to make an important decision. I would have to choose whether I want to make the revolution or the PhD. Both simultaneously gonna be a little bit different. Then when I just finished the PhD, precisely one day like this one, 23 of February, but 37 years ago, I was the first Spaniard on making an experiment on a synchrotron radiation. It was the very old anodico de Cienderse. I think that you have never seen even that project. It was well before Superco. And we were doing the experiment with the help, it was also something very unusual, with the help of a theoretician. Felicity Wright was bringing the liquid nitrogen to field in the way of cooling the sample of that bomb. We were trying to measure the exchange splitting in a single mole of cobalt and copper. It was a prediction by Felix, who was most of the real good theoreticians are able not simply to fit the sound, but to make predictions that we can then prove that are wrong in these cases. But that was, this one was not wrong. And it was exactly the, for the Spaniards, it was a very important day. It was exactly the day in which some people were trying to destroy the Spanish democracy by occupying the Congress and bringing tanks on the street. So we both were sort of, Felix and me were isolated, of course, over there without news in detail of how was the situation in Spain. And so much scare. Miguel, my eldest son, was 1 month old at that time. So I was really scared not to be able to come back to Spain again and miss my family. And Frederick Petrov was still a kid, but his father was a very important physicist in France at that moment and director of all this business of Lyon, the lab for synchrotron radiation over there. He saw how desperate we were and said, well, don't worry, you need to stay here, we will find some job for you, which was okay. It was again very interesting moment in life. Then we moved to Germany. I mean, we was with Maria del Mar, of course, Miguel, including the guitar and the yellow car that we had at the time. I don't know for. I was so fortunate to be in this institute, under the supervision of Professor Ertel, is shown here in front of the statue that was directly in front of this, the Sophia Strasse. But it was really Professor Bandel, the one who was in charge of leading me through all the different things that I had to learn in this period of time in my career. It was a very happy time, so we were doing excellent experiment. There was very few groups in the world at that moment could be able to do photo emission at low temperature, very low temperature. I was very fortunate to collaborate with Ezequiel Urbano, a very good friend of mine, who was doing a postdoc there from Argentina. Have a very nice German student who was doing his PhD, Stefan Weiser over there. And we even had some time to take a walk, of course, carrying Miguelito on the back through the beautiful landscape in, close to Munich. We even had time to enjoy the botanical garden, sort of Casa Campo, or one of these places in garden in the town that are so nice to enjoyable during the brief summertime in Germany. That's Miguelito, who at that moment was enjoying also the thing of playing guitar, because that was the only way in which I could play guitar, so that he could also have another guitar, because otherwise he was so jealous of the time and the attention that I was paying to the guitar that he had to contribute also to the music at that moment. But it was a very nice and tender age. Well, then I came back to Spain, and I was again, I have always been very lucky, that's true. And I was also lucky at that moment to be able to take advantage of the installation of the first STM in Spain. And for those of you that are young and work with STM, that was the way it was looking in STM those days. The first, I mean, the size of this thing is typically one, slightly larger than 1 meter. So it was something very, very large. It was, in fact, we need to have this microscope. This was built by IBM at the moment in Rushlicon by Mr. Gerber and Jaime Roller, getting it. It was brought to Spain in the backside of the car of Mr. Gerber, entering in a funny way also the, crossing the border. And finally it was installed in the lab. And since at that time they were thinking that the STM requires the use of ultra high vacuum, we thought, well, we need to introduce this thing so big in ultra high vacuum chamber. And the only chamber that we had at that moment at that size was the molecular beam machine, the helium diffraction machine in the lab. But something that took our good friend Joaquin Ibanez, who I don't know is sitting around, 8 years to build. So I thought, well, my God, destroying this work of 8 years just to put this microscope inside. And I asked very stupid thing. So would something happen if we do try to work the microscope in air? I said, well, no, I don't think it. And do you really think we will not destroy the electronics or anything? No. Why don't we try? So then we save the UHV chamber. So we try in air, and we were very fortunate because we did we took some pictures of the samples that we used at the time. That's a closer view of the first STM over there. It was. Very hard to recognize. That was the heart of the microscope at that moment. Hard to recognize today for the instruments that we have today. And so we start working with a multidisciplinary team, as Pepe Carrascosa was mentioning before. And this is Pepe Carrascosa, precisely at that moment. Well, that's me. And that's a picture that was taken for a Spanish newspaper, for El País, who echoed this thing of installing this microscope in Spain and getting the first measurement. I was here faking that I was doing something related to a microscope, because for the journalist it was impossible to believe that there was a microscope and you don't look through something, there was a microscope. So it was fake. But Pepe Carrascosa was also faking that, I mean, he's a biologist, playing with a lot of knobs in the electronics, which is also not true. Arturo Boró was also looking very carefully to something that was over there. And but after all, we were lucky enough to get very quickly some fantastic results, like showing that graphite was flat, something that was already very well known, and that there were atomic steps on surfaces, something that was already very well known. But you see these traces, that's exactly the kind of image that you get at that moment. It was made with the plotter. So when we try to have a look at some more sophisticated thing, and the idea, as Pepe mentioned, was to have a look at biological material and see if we could image this thing with some detail, in particular like this famous 529 virus that he's so fond of. Well, we use graphite as a surface because it was very flat, so there was nothing in the surface that can be mistaken. When you see some rough things, it has to be something related to the biological material, more or less, let's say. And we were able to take images after a lot of the processing were looking like that, which was enough similar to the reconstruction in three dimensions that they have from electron microscopy. So that was a very good hint that this microscope was bringing something interesting, because in principle that image was taken in air, or to be more precise, even in the liquid that were the virus would be in principle. So we published this thing with all these colleagues that later got the Nobel Prize. The real images are shown here. They were just line scans. And from this few line scan, and a lot of magic at IBM processing the images, you get the images that I showed before. So that people get a lot of impact in, even in the society. There was a journal in the país that was published that several people were contributing to write explanation of how important was this thing and so on. But I think being part of this very early community of STM was like a blessing for me. It was an historical meeting. It was the first meeting of the, by then, young STM community. So you see here Christoph Gerber, really built the instrument following the essentially the ideas and suggestions of Billy, who was extremely clever in bringing things ideas. And Harry Rohrer, who took a very important role in this development, because essentially, to me, he was protecting Billy for many years at IBM. More than 5 years he was working at IBM without publishing anything. And that's not within the style of IBM research of those days. So protecting, simply saying how important was the thing that this guy is trying to develop, let's give them some more time. I think it was very, very important. Well, I was also there. I was this, at that time, young and ambitious scientist trying to learn from these guys as much as I can. And then I came back to Spain. As I said, I was very lucky in the trying to put again put a lab that could compete internationally at that level. You have seen this picture before. There are a number of people much younger than, including Jorge and Julio and Jesus, who talked yesterday, and somebody else that I will mention in more detail very soon. By the way, this gentleman here, believe it or not, is Amadeo. So it's time. And we started again collaborating with people that help us very much in this moment in developing our capabilities in doing experiment here in Spain, experiment that could be competitive internationally. We have a fantastic collaboration with Jürgen Kirchner. Here's a picture of Jürgen the way you usually find it, man. He used to be the director of a mass plan who spent more time directly working on the machine than I have seen in my life. He's still, probably still, he have a UHP chamber in his desk or very close to his office for his own sake to do experiment on, with his own hands on weekends. I don't know how it's taken by your wife, but okay, that's another point. So at that time, he mentioned that we did together some very nice work in which we put together our knowledge of how to grow in detail, in a very controlled way, the number of layers that you want on the surface. We discovered, thanks to the work of a lot of people in the lab, including Salvador and Alejandro and Juanjo de Miguel, that there was a way which something that you can measure. In fact, then we learned many things that you can measure. Oscillates with periodicity of a single monolayer. When you grow something on the surface, it is growing really like a monolayer. So we use this tool to count the number of layers in a very precise way, and then being able to measure by magnetoptic effect, that was the first thing that we mounted here, also to be able to measure in situ the magnetic properties, and then seeing the, how the equilibrium temperature was changing with the number of layers. That was a very, very important work and the start of a very fruitful collaboration with Jürgen, as he was mentioning before. We learned so much from him that I'm really grateful of that. And then we decided that it's, since this story of a single monolayer, it looks like, you see, it's the nature of trying to fit something when you have not too many data. But if you fit this thing, it looks like it, for a single monolayer, it will go to zero, the equilibrium temperature. So we decided, well, we have to check that. It's very difficult to do it in this way because perhaps we don't have enough signal. So let's try to go and make super lattices of copper. Copper. We know how to grow this thing very well. We can count the number of layers. We can produce this structure extremely good. And then, since we have the repetition of many times this single layer or a few layers, then we can check the magnetic properties of this thing by a real measurement, like the neutron diffraction. And we went to Grenoble. We had a lot of fun learning neutron diffraction and on the library of the ILL, because we had no idea of neutron diffraction before, but we were very interested in studying this thing even late at night. We did the diffraction and we find something completely unexpected. Apart from the peaks of diffraction coming from the periodicity, from the structural periodicity, so the size of this period, okay? Apart from that, we have a peak that was at half this distance in reciprocal space, which means that you have something magnetic, because it disappears when you apply magnetic field and all this type of thing, which indicates that in this particular thickness you have an antiferromagnetic coupling between the covalent layers separated by this copper stuff. Very unexpected. No one really seems to understand why this thing was this way. And then we went even farther, and then, okay, of course, the obvious thing was trying to see how this antiferromagnetic coupling changes when you change the thickness of the copper layer, of the copper space in between. And when we did that, and that's a copy from my book lab, that those days, we found something totally unusual. It was, the coupling was what is called ferromagnetic, so the alignment of magnetization was parallel for 2, 3, and 4 layers, anti-parallel for 5, 6, and 7, parallel for 8, 9, and 10. So it was something oscillating with a strict, perfect periodicity. And so we saw, well, that's really, that's something amazing. It's really unbelievable. And so, and then we know the periodicity, so I went to my favorite theorist, Felix Durán, who was at the office next door to mine. I showed him the result. I said, look, that's amazing. I mean, it's really hard to understand this this periodicity. And he said, well, have you looked at the Fermi surface of copper? He said, well, no. I said, well, I think it's related to the size of the Fermi surface of copper. And I said, well, where can I get the surface Fermi of copper? He said, well, it's in the front page of Kittel. Oh. So I took the Kittel, I have a picture of that, I measured the best that I can, I came by very excited and said, Felix, it fits perfectly well. It is exactly this thing. So we have to publish something, it's very important, you see. It's a, he said, well, how can you publish something that is on the front cover of the Kittel? So, well, but then I was less enthusiastic. I thought, well, maybe it's a very stupid thing. But it was not. It was not. We simply missed the right experiment. Because the right experiment is trying to measure the resistance of this thing. It's a metallic thing. And the resistance changes when you have parallel or anti-parallel orientation. And that's the giant magnetoresistance effect. So we missed at that time completely the right point of this, the important point of this story. But we were very happy with this basic result at that time. What is The postman always ring twice. So let me tell you another story of how we miss something that could have been very important. The next generation of STM was much smaller. So the next generation of STM was of this size. It was called a pocket size STM because it fit into your pocket. It was again design of Christoph Gerber. I was very fortunate to be with him and Gerbinik when they invented one night over the dinner the essential parts of this new type of design of the microscope. And amazed to see that the next day, by noon, next day, Christoph was already being able to build this part and test this thing. So it was really a team that was a missing one. Well, of course, when you have a new microscope, you have to test it with something. The way to test classically in those days the microscope was to have a look in air to graphite to see if everything was fine and flat and you don't have additional noise and you see the steps and things like that. So you exfoliate graphite with a scotch tape. The scotch tape is here. And now you can amplify the scotch tape. And there are some things in the scotch tape. So maybe we also, at that moment, miss graphene. Maybe it was there, but of course, we were absolutely unaware of anything like that could really happen. The next important moment that I would like to highlight is related to the first moment in which we really have, for the first time in Spain, atomic solution with the STM. That's an historical image, it's untreated, it's raw data, and you see the noise. I mean, these things are the atoms of silicon, in this case, which were at the external surface of the material that we were testing at the moment. This is the result of the noise in the microscope because of the excitement that we had. We were jumping all around the chamber, hugging each other, and with the very famous word from that moment when we start seeing the first thing, the famous word was, yes, those are the atoms. So that was again a very important moment, I think, for many of us. Then came Klaus Heinz. Well, we were, someone said I was in love with the STM, it's true. But then you realize also some defects in your lower hands, right? So it was fantastic, the STM, but you cannot see anything below the surface. So you don't really know how is the crystallography that you are looking at. So the obvious thing was, okay, let's, what is the best and the simplest technique in principle that you can use to do real quantitative crystallography? Well, the low energy electron diffraction. Who is the man that knows about anything that you would like to ask? Professor Klaus Heinz. So why don't we try to have put together and lead an STM in the same chamber? So that we can look at the same sample with lead and STM simultaneously. And then from that, we'll learn another thing. We did learn another thing. It's true, we published a lot of very nice papers. We discovered many different things, the origin of we confirm, in fact, the origin of the triangles pointing in different directions that Juan was mentioning the other day. And we had a lot of fun together, including this number of different ECOS conferences. But I want to highlight this one because this guy over here is Mario. Mario is sitting now also in the audience. He came all the way from Argentina to participate in this. We're really, really happy that is around. Time passes, however. So by year 2000, that was about the group of people involved in this business, including our new acquisition by that time, Daniel Farias, who was coming from Germany, did the PhD over there. That's Salvador Ferrer, we have seen him already in these days around. And that's Roberto Otero, sitting in the front of Professor Rojo, now has a right there at that moment. And Julio Gil is also at the right. But the sensation of growing was continuously increasing, and there was a moment in which we were able to have, for the first time, an ion accelerator in this university. It was created as a first infrastructure of the science park that has been measured several times during the time in which I was helping Raul Villar at the rectorate. And one of the things that happened once that the building was there and the accelerator was there, that it was recognized that you would need to have some sort of surface science lab that would help identify people there. And then José Emilio and Juan de la Figuera were in charge of building many of this equipment over there. So you see here a lot of the people that you have seen around these days, a much younger Fabian, Enrique, Pilar is also around, or at least in morning, Cristina, so a lot of colleagues and friends that were helping to advance all the wisdom science. And we missed it again. The postman ringing twice or three times or whatever, and we were never listening to the postman. That's graphene. I showed this thing yesterday. For years, we were growing graphene every morning on ruthenium. Well, that's an image taken in 2002, but there are many from even from before, but that's the one I had in my laptop. We were growing graphene, you know, without knowing, because we simply heat the crystal early in the morning, and then you have some carbon being segregated from ruthenium. The segregation ends up when you complete the first monolayer, and you have something on the surface that now we know is graphene. But at that time, we thought it was carbon contamination, so we destroy this thing every morning. First thing you do, you heat the crystal, you see carbon is there, so graphene, then you bombard the crystal. When you have a coffee, you are destroying the next opportunity of measuring things with graphene. So we are not as clever as we think we are. We are missing continuously opportunities. Well, now it's time for something that, I hope is not a missed opportunity. When the IDEA was created, and Bonnie was mentioning this thing in detail, and also Manuel with love for this institution, we were very lucky because it was on PowerPoint, Manuel said. Well, we were very lucky to have a lot of friends in this university, a lot of complicities in the university, so some of our friends were able to give us some space in the building of the sciences here in the university. So very quickly, when IDEA was created, it became like a small place where physically you can have something. You can have a lab, you can have an office, you can take some visitors, so it was a little bit more than this PowerPoint dream. So for many years, look at that, for many years, that was IDEA. In these conditions, but to me still is a surprise, we were able to convince a lot of people, excellent scientists, to join this dream. And we had very little to show, except a couple of labs over there, a couple of offices, and many of them joined in this condition. Danny did, I mean, it was mentioned Johannes, but a lot of people did. So I really wondered how I was able to convince them, because I have nothing in my hand except the dream that something could be done in this direction. But again, we were very lucky. So after 6 or 7 years of collecting every year a little bit of money from saving from here and there, because no one gave a lot of money, no. And Bonnie said that the cost of this building was 12 million. 12 million is almost nothing, it's true, but nobody gave us 12 million. Or 13 million, or anything like, no, 2 million, nothing like that. So we were saving every year from here and there and doing all sorts of funny things. Until one day in January 2010, it was snowing. It was the moment to lay the first stone. And that was a group of people laying what you have inside this box, so-called first stone ceremony consisting that you hide this type of box somewhere in the ground, and then you put newspapers with the day and things like that. But someone from the office of the president of the regional government told me, look, the director also has the right to introduce something into this boxer. And I said, aha, so what can we do? So, and then that's what I introduced. It's a CD here that contains a private joke. It contains all the songs by the Beatles, plus one. One that some of you heard yesterday night, and it's there. Well, it's perhaps arrogant on my side to believe that it could be compared with the real thing, but I thought it as a joke for the archaeologists of the future. So one day, perhaps in 600 years or around 2,000 years or something like that, this is destroyed, and someone looked and found this thing and recovered that and opened it. Hopefully it's conserved, this thing, and then they find it's the complete list of recording by a very famous group in the 20th century or something like that, but there's something additional. There's an additional song that was unknown, and perhaps they think that it's another unknown song, which is not. Okay. Now it's up to you, I will not disclose which one of the songs that you heard yesterday. It's over there, but perhaps you can imagine. Well, in a very short period of time, the building was growing. That part that you see over here are the foundations of the Center of Nanofabrication, two levels below the level at which we are. The main work of Daniel for many, many years to make sure that this thing works properly. And then finally, we were finishing the thing. In all this adventure with India, I was again very lucky. I don't know exactly why. I was able to convince Ivan. I had so many interesting things to do in life, to spend a lot of energy, really a lot of energy, in helping this thing of India appear. In particular, one very important contribution was to come with me to speak with someone from the regional government who was in love of speaking English. And although many of you know that Ivan speaks Spanish better than me, I told him, look, you want to speak English. Uh-huh. And it worked. So that was also a very important contribution. Well, before we finish the building, something very sad happened. Our dear friend and colleague, and the one who mounted the first STM, the first machine, in fact, that we had at India, in the building, Juan Alejos, unexpectedly died. That was the last picture that was taken from him, and the only thing we could do for him is remember. And then we dedicated him a room, another seminar room, which is also here on the floor, where on the wall is a reproduction of this picture. For those of you that know him, I think if you have not seen this place, I think it's worth it, because that's the way in which we can really have a memory. No one is gone if someone has still his memory. But okay, it was a very happy day on the January 13, 4 years ago, when the in this very same place, as you see, it's a very elegant room, much like all the others in there. We had the official inauguration of this place. There were many people sitting there. It was a lot of fun. And these ladies and gentlemen helped us also very much in many publishing this thing. So finally, this thing is a reality. We can all enjoy it. I really hope it's something that is useful for the younger generation. This has not been done to the glory of us that are as old as I am now, but to help you to develop your career. That's really what it's behind all this effort, to bring you back if you are abroad, if you are Spanish, you want to work here, or if you are a foreigner, to offer you a possibility to develop your scientific career also in our country, which I think it's really worth. So enjoy and take advantage of that. Of course, all this summary of my time basically doing science, that's what I have mentioned, would have been completely impossible without Maria Lamar, but she knows this thing already, and I don't need to insist on that. I don't need to insist that the I never dream, in fact, of well, I dream, but I was scared. But I mean, it's I create something that is much better than the, because I contribute a bit, I hope, to create life. And these two guys that you have seen before are part of the best thing in my life. And of course, the follower, the little Juan and Diego. Danny was mentioning that no one has shown this type of thing. Well, that's my favorite advice for a young scientist. The thing that I consider as a motto of this institute is this type of drawing. I mean, you might feel like everything is lost, but don't ever give up. Fight for your dreams. Because if you fight for your dreams, there is a chance that the dream will come true. If you become desperate and forget your dreams, you will never get them realized. So I will finish again, to not be any other way, by mentioning something that is related to the Beatles. In a way, this is a translation, well, that's really the last verse of the last song that the Beatles recorded. And the last verse, I think, is beautiful. And in the end, the love you take is equal to the love you make, which is what I translate in a way. I mentioned briefly that some of you were not yesterday in the dinner, so I will repeat myself. So if you really want to know how many people love you, all you have to do is to count how many people do you really love, because in general, it's the same number. It doesn't mean that it's exactly the same people, but almost exactly the same people. There might be some exception, but it's... And then I really feel so proud and happy to have you around that I have no other words to say, except, of course, thank you. I'm thanking you with the picture taken from the work of the daughter of Chipo, Maria Angels, and our beloved Elena. It's a picture of Maria by night. And some of you were yesterday night here, but some of you were not. So one of the last song that we played yesterday contains a few words giving the thanks for, thank you for a very special day, for a very special morning, and thank you if there is even half a chance that we will have one more morning, one more day together. So thank you really from the bottom of my heart. I really feel moved by all your love that you are showing.